Right, so hospital radio, what were you actually doing in those days? How were you getting these interviews? Because you've been doing them since the mid-50s.
Yes, well, early 50s, actually. We were presenting records at Clatterbridge Hospital in 1951 and then at Cleaver Hospital, Heswell, in 1955. And to add a little spice to the programme, rather than just have people's names going out, I thought it'd be rather nice to meet some of the people who make the records. And the very first person I interviewed, in fact, was Jack Jackson, a disc jockey, who told me how to present records. I found that the staff at the Empire Theatre were very cooperative when I went to interview him, and so I maintained that contact, particularly with the stage doorkeeper. It was much more important to know him than to know the management.
Did you find many people actually doing interviews in those days when you went to the theatre?
No, I had a limited time with the artists, but it was usually not for interview purposes. The other people in the queue ahead of me were press photographers normally.
You took a tape recorder on location with you, didn't you? Now, that also would be unusual in those days.
Very unusual, because those were in my poverty-stricken days. It was before I had a portable tape recorder, so it was a mains machine that I took round, which was quite heavy. It weighed about 35 pounds. And to get power to it was difficult, because I usually had to plug into the one of the lamps around the dressing table mirrors in the dressing rooms. And to prevent people from using the electrical appliances, they had screw fittings rather than bayonet fittings, so I had to have an adapter as well. So it took me about 5 minutes to rig up before I could do any interviews.
Now, what would have happened at the Empire that week in March 1960? Would you have gone along on spec to try and get interviews, or would you have rung someone up?
I'd have gone on spec, and that, in fact, is what I did. Again, knowing the stage doorkeeper, he could talk people round to being helpful.
And how did you find Jean and Eddie as personalities? What do you remember?
Rather scruffy was my impression, because they were lolling around and I had to chase after them with the microphones. And I recall that they were both smoking and they weren't very tidy with their ash or their cigarette ends. It was rather a scrubby affair, I thought, in the dressing room. But very friendly, very friendly people.
Now, they often answered in just words of one syllable or a short sentence. Would you have rather that they'd have come out with a whole anecdote?
Oh, yes. Yes, that was what I wanted. But I was worried about several things. Was the machine working? Was I offending anybody by overstaying my time and that sort of thing? Naturally, I wanted more of their voice on tape than mine, but it worked out the other way around in the early days.
And what about Billy Fury? That was the first time you met him, was it?
Yes, first time I met him was at the Empire with the screaming girls outside the window. A most likeable lad, I thought. And the second time, he came with me to Port Sunlight to do a lunchtime record programme. I used to present records in the lunchtime for the factory workers.
Did you therefore invite him when you met him?
Yes, I invited him and Joe Brown. And thereby hangs a tale, actually. Well, two tales. Because Billy Fury, I took on a walking tour of Port Sunlight Village, and he asked me confidentially if he could buy one of the houses. Well, of course, they were tied cottages then, so I said, only if you work for Leavers you can have one of these. But most likable youngster, you couldn't help but like him. Very, very shy, didn't want to talk on stage. He didn't mind singing, but he wasn't fussy on talking. Wasn't very happy with me because I introduced him with a record called Gonna Type a Letter, which he thought was dreadful, but I still like. The other tale is Joe Brown, because after we'd done the lunchtime record programme, we went to the Bridge Inn, which is a posh hotel in Port Sunlight Village, for lunch. Of course, it was a late lunch because we didn't finish the second house until 2 o'clock, and the service was pretty dreadful. And Joe Brown had a starting pistol on his person, as the police would say, and we'd had our soup and our main course, and we were waiting for the suite, and we were waiting probably 10 minutes. The Bridge Inn was like a cathedral in those days, very quiet and very sober. But Joe Brown produced this starting pistol and fired it in the air, and people came crashing through doors all round, you know. So those were two things that I recall from Billy Fury and Joe Brown.
Okay, thanks, Monty.
Spencer, thank you very much.